All right. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ryan Maloney. I work at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, helping out with the programming and the education work. We just had a chance to hear a little intro music that hopefully got your bodies moving a little bit. One of the key themes today will be bodies moving. So we're excited to have you here for another episode of Music on the Brain, which is part of our ongoing partnership with the Zuckerman Institute over at Columbia University. We've been doing this for a while now, where we get together the great Helen Sung, composer, band leader, pianist, an all-around wonderful person, gets to know one of the neuroscientists over at the Zuckerman, and they talk about some of the intersectionalities between music and neuroscience. And it's a really fun way for us to think about music in different ways and think about the brain in different ways. And those of us on the music end get a chance to explore and learn a little bit more about the brain. And those on the brain end of things get a chance to hear a little bit more of how this might come together in a musical setting. So excited to be here, and thank you. I want to welcome you all on behalf of our executive director, Tracy Hyder-Suffren, along with our creative directors, Christian McBride and Jonathan Batiste, and our board of trustees. We want to welcome you all to our feed today. If you don't mind, you can share this event out. We already have a nice crowd gathering both on Facebook and YouTube, but if you take a moment and share it out within your network, we want to get as many folks involved here as we can. Those of you who are new to the Jazz Museum in Harlem, we are located on 129th Street, just off of Lenox Avenue in New York City, in the neighborhood of Harlem. And we are still closed to the public as a result of the global pandemic, but we will be opening up again in 2021 at some point, so stay tuned for that. Throughout today's event, we will have opportunities for you guys to join in with the fun. And you will see things like this. Do you have any questions? You can put your answers in the comment. This is an interactive session. We hope that you guys will join us in this session. So at different times throughout, Helen and our guest neuroscientist Najja will be asking you guys for your feedback and your participation. So please feel free to type those in the Facebook chat, and we will get you guys involved as well. So let's get started. Thank you guys again for joining us. I want to introduce our musician and host for the evening, or for the afternoon. Let's all give a home live stream welcome to Helen Sung. Yay, Helen! Yay!
Thank you, Ryan. It's always great to see you. And again, I so appreciate the collaboration and partnership with you and, of course, the Zuckerman Institute. And as I always do, I'd love to start our live stream with a little bit of music. Last week, I had the opportunity to be a part of a tribute to the pianist Bud Powell. We played a lot of his music in a jazz piano trio setting that was filmed at Birdland Jazz Club, and it will be broadcast at a later date, so y'all can stay tuned regarding that. So let's start off with some Bud Powell. This is his beautiful Dusk in Sandy, and one of his compositions I actually didn't know about and really enjoy playing, called Cleopatra's Dance. you so much. So as Ryan said, today our series, Music on the Brain, we're talking about music in motion, thinking about physical movement, how it happens, why it happens, the neuroscience behind it all. And I'm so excited about today's guest. You're going to love him. I want to welcome him on stage now, Mr. Najja Marshall, and he will tell you a little bit about his story, how he got into science, and his research today. So welcome, Najja. I'm so happy to see you again and talk a little bit more.
Thank you, Helen. That was really very lovely.
Thanks.
So my pathway into science, I've really been into math and science for about as long as I can remember. I still have fond memories of, racing my best friend when I was a kid to get to science class because they were just so eager to learn. led me to, I studied math and physics at Indiana University, Bloomington. And there I sort of started getting into research. So my freshman year, I started working in this biocomplexity institute. And biocomplexity is essentially the study of sort of emergent complex properties within neural systems through a combination of math, physics, computer science, neuroscience, of course. So really there we were, working on trying to understand how cell cultures that are grown in a dish develop these emergent properties. And, that was kind of a very sort of low level project. And then from there, I applied to the theoretical neuroscience program here at Columbia University. And I kind of took a big leap from there to working, studying motor control in monkeys. So it's kind of a big leap from cells grown in a dish to monkeys. But it's really been a lot of fun, and excited to tell you what I'm working on.
So I'm just curious, did people think it was odd that you were running to science class? Because was it biology or chemistry or this was grade school you're talking about?
Yeah, grade school.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what was it about? Like, you didn't? Do you remember what y'all were studying or?
I recall that we had a particularly great science teacher. Very engaging, just like one of those people, that everyone just remembers fondly for years to come. So, and I think it's also just a bit of that I was a science nerd even as a kid. So
I love that. But I also think it's, I just want to take a quick second just to give a shout out to teachers, especially right
yes.
now, what's going through. I really think teachers are such heroes and we want to thank them. And same, I had a teacher in high school, chemistry teacher, who was awesome. And I loved chemistry as a result of it, although I wasn't that good. There were these things called unknowns with labs where you had to identify what kind of ions and whatever and solution. I just could never seem to get them. But anyway, I think that's awesome. Your journey sounds amazing. And to go from your grade school days and now at one of the premier neuroscience research facilities, it's just congratulations and so excited to talk about movement. So, everybody here, what are some ways that humans move? I think one way, running to science class, that's one way. So if you guys out there, if they're just, I think it's, we all move, right?
And truly the range is just vast, so.
Yes, and I think in terms of human beings, one group subset, we call them athletes, have refined their ability to control and do amazing movements. And I know this is one of my favorite, most amazing people that I can think of. And Najja, do you want to share this video?
Sure. Yeah, I think many people may recognize this.
Here we go, right off the bat, the very first tumbling pass, triple twisting, double back.
Money! Just keep making history, Simone Biles. Thank you.
Wow.
Alrighty. Well,
that is what you call gravity defying, I think.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. They call pianists and musicians, we're called micro athletes because unfortunately we can't, our muscles are not as impressively evident when we play. But let's dig in a little bit to just the neuroscience behind movement in terms of what has been kind of a, has there been an evolution of how science has seen the mechanics, the physical processes behind physical movement in humans?
Sure, yeah, so I can kind of walk you through. I'll start by just noting if I think my screen isn't. So it's interesting to also note that, you know, most animals do move, and but there are some few interesting exceptions. So this C-squirt is really interesting in that it is a creature that in its early part of its life cycle, you know, it starts as a larva, you know, looks a lot like a tadpole swimming around in the sea, and soon into its cycle, it actually dives headfirst onto a rock and essentially plants itself there. And once it lands on that rock, it actually eats or really absorbs its entire primitive nervous system. And so there are some maybe motor chauvinists that sort of say that this is some evidence that, you know, the nervous system really evolved primarily to support movement.
So when you say the nervous system, I'm sorry, I should know this by now, but just so I'm sure, does that include the brain or is that a separate system from the brain?
Yes, yeah, because these, you know, these primitive nervous systems don't really have what we would call a brain per se. But yeah, the sort of precursors to a brain that, you know, that we see in more complex species, you know, some argue that really exists to subserve movement. And so then when we get into, you know, the actual processes that actually underlie movement, so the sort of main center, right, so, you know, as for every function that the brain does, you know, whether it's audition, sensation, there are dedicated regions that are focused on generating movement. So area 4, or the primary motor cortex, is center that's largely attributed to movement execution. And then this area 6 is what's called the premotor cortex, and so that's largely involved with movement planning. And so these two regions are located at the back of the frontal lobe here. And then when you sort of consider the sequence of the flow of information that underlies movement planning and execution, you know, it sort of broadly speaking involves a, you know, integration of inputs from sensory areas that then flow into these premotor areas and then into primary motor cortex. And then ultimately the output signals of motor cortex travel down the spinal cord to affect movement. And so if we sort of look at this whole, you know, pathway, you know, so really there are multiple pathways here that underlie this process, but essentially the outputs of motor cortex, you know, make their way through the spinal cord, and then ultimately reach these neurons in these within the spinal cord that then connect onto the muscles. And so the focus of my research is understanding how these spinal motor neurons are controlled to affect movement.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can
so
I ask
I
a
guess
quick question about that C squirt again.
Sure. Yes.
So, I think we can posit most living beings move, as in the sense that we understand physical movement. So that's, C-squirt doesn't have a brain per se, like you said, but there is a neural system there at the very beginning that enables movement. But for some reason, it chooses to go head first into a rock. So it has a head, like you said. It
yeah.
Has a, what you, with eyes and stuff?
It does have a like primitive eye and a organ for, you know, maintaining balance as it's moving through the water.
Okay.
Yeah.
But then it seems like, wow, so I never thought of it that way, how the neural system, first of all, like you said, it's evolved to facilitate and help enable movement. And it makes sense, you know, our spinal cord, very protective, right, of these must be very fine, you know, long, thin what do you call them? Neurons that run all up and down the spine. And so these are the triggers for movement in the muscles, right? So does it go into one muscle and that one that next muscle triggers another muscle, or do these neurons go through all, like all the way to our fingertips?
Do you mean at the level of the neurons from the brain, or these spinal motor neurons?
Oh, I see. Right. It's like a tag team.
Yeah. So, you know, these pyramidal tract neurons, you know, converge onto multiple. So these output neurons from the brain converge onto, you know, multiple spinal neurons.
Got it.
And it's those spinal neurons that then each of them sends connections to some set of fibers within just a single muscle. So each of these spinal neurons is essentially responsible for just generating muscle contractions within a individual muscle.
Got it. Okay. So you had a great analogy about kind of like the understanding of general movement, how it happens mechanically. Can you share that analogy?
Sure. Yeah. So, I mean, my project is largely focused on trying to understand how this population, right? So it's, you know, not just three motor neurons here, but there's, you know, hundreds that are responsible for controlling contractions within a single muscle. And so my project is focused on understanding how that population of neurons is coordinated to produce various types of patterns of muscle activations. And so a sort of major, I guess, sort of focus or sort of implication is that we're trying to sort of push back on some longstanding theories about how these populations of neurons are actually controlled. And yeah, so the analogy I use to explain this is that of how we drive a car. So if you imagine when you want to get your car, well, so, you know, driving a car essentially involves three main actors. So there's the person behind the wheel of the car who is calling all the shots. There's the engine of your car, you know, that actually is, you know, generating the actual impetus to move. And that, of course, interfaces with the car body and the, you know, wheels that actually propel you through the environment. And the sort of key thing as far as, you know, when you want your car to move, you don't really care how the engine works. All you do is just step on the gas pedal. Right, you just say, I just need you to move this fast. I don't really care how you do it. Just take care of the rest. And so by analogy, you can think of the motor system as having sort of three similar components. So there's your brain, which is, you know, the executive that, like I was explaining earlier, is involved with planning movements, executing movements, you know, integrating lots of various inputs. There's your spinal cord with these lower motor neurons that then, you know, synapse directly onto the muscles, which, you know, are connected obviously to your skeleton and would actually is essentially responsible for propelling you through your environment. And so, yeah, so some really long-standing ideas as far as how these motor neurons are actually controlled essentially is really analogous to how we drive a car. And the thinking is basically that the brain sends a sort of single command down to this particular population of neurons, you know, essentially saying, I don't really care how you are activated or in sort of what pattern, I just need you to produce this much muscle force and take care of the rest. And so basically my research is focused on, you know, saying, well, maybe in certain contexts, the brain might want to leverage these neurons in more flexible ways. And so my project is, you know, trying to understand what are these contexts and then how are these neurons controlled in these various manners.
Well, that really resonates with the question I had, because I think we can all agree that music is a powerful force that moves us. In fact, there's a quote that Ryan shared yesterday by the American artist Jean-Michel Basquiat, who said, if you can't dance to John Coltrane, then you can't dance, which I thought was a great quote. But, you know, we all we love different types of music because we're all different. What we might like something different than somebody else. And just personally, from my experience, when I listen to music, especially music that gets me going, I'll realize, oh, my foot just started tapping and I didn't tell my brain, like you said there on the diagram, I don't think I told my foot for my brain to move, and or my head starts bobbing. And So that's so interesting to me. So it's like, do my feet have a mind of their own? Or, I mean, is this kind of related to these finer, more nuanced activities that you just mentioned in your research?
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, certainly, so my research is in a sense very, you know, low level. It's, you know, kind of trying to understand a sort of automatic process that, you know, unfolds sort of, you know, after you've decided to move or once you've, you know, felt the inspiration to move through music. And I think we're going to maybe touch on some of the, you know, processes that are, that sort of underlie the, you know, human ability to perceive beats, and then also that underlies this sort of innate ability to, you know, nod along with music.
Yes. Yes. Which I think I remember from a previous episode that we had, and we talked about it, how humans seem uniquely able to do that along with a few couple of other species of beings. And I thought it'd be fun. Let's, you know, this whole idea of movement, it's probably a set of very, it's many series of events, right? From the brain, from the neurons in the brain to the motor neurons and then to the muscles. So I like to play some music, and I want people to think consciously, and we would love for you to share your thoughts. Like, as you listen to each piece, think about what in the music would make you want to move, or some of it makes you what? You know, we talked about melody, rhythm, and harmony. So those are some of the elements of music. So let's take a listen. Brave souls from our audience today, what parts of that song made you want to move, didn't want to move? My feelings won't be hurt if it didn't make you want to move, by the way. The lively beat. Thank you, Iris. Okay, break that down a little bit. What made that beat? Were there parts, the right hand, the left hand? Pattern sequences. Oh, Mike, good to see you. Hey. Well, Mike knows what he's talking about. Yeah, pattern sequences. The bass part, yes. Yeah, really good. I think repetition and discrete patterns, that's a very important part of rhythm and the groove. Thanks. The bass line, yeah. Wonderful. Okay, here's the second piece.
Mm-hmm.
piece by Bud Powell, another nod to that really fun gig I did last Tuesday. It's about Paris, his impressions about Paris, called Parisian Thoroughfare. Anything about that song? Syncopation made me. Ah, yeah, thank you. Yeah, jazz is all about that. The offbeats, the up and downs. Okay, yeah. Alternating thing, yeah, great. This piece had so many interesting harmonies that it made me want to listen. You know, and that's a great point, because with bebop, jazz artists, this is a music that is virtuosic, complex, and they wanted to be respected as serious musicians, like classical musicians. So I totally agree. That totally reflects the history of the music, where it started turning to be more of a music that you listen to rather than you dance to, and it's reflected in that piece. So, and you guys are a terrific audience, so smart. Repetition, yep. Thank you, Beth. Right and left hands. Yes, the back and forth, oompa oompa almost. That's taken from a Clifford Brown, Max Roach arrangement. Here's the last one. I'm gonna take the headphones off for this one. It's kind of a tricky piece. Makes you want to move. Good. Fast pulse moves you. Ah, thank you. That piece is also by Bud Powell, called Tempest Fugit. That to me sounds a little bit like kind of a classical title that you would hear, you know, Latin in there somewhere. And he had very strong classical training. And even though that song had a lot of notes, I thought the big beats make it danceable. So even though it's... Good. Awesome. Yeah, that's bebop. Well, thank you so much for your responses and for listening. And, you know, now I would love to welcome Najja back and talk a little bit more. You know, now that you've decided to move, or I've decided to move, how does the nervous system, the brain, motor neurons, muscles, how does it coordinate to make that happen? And I think I'm excited to talk about your research with an experiment that you actually created.
Yes, thank you. It's very, very, very impressive. Your hands are just moving like a mile a minute. all these movements, you know, whether we're playing piano or for a, you know, gymnast tumbling or even doing something as simple as just, you know, holding a glass of water up in the air, it all relies on, you know, contracting your muscles in just the right way, which is all driven by these spinal motor neurons. And, you know, as I mentioned in the slide that I just showed, the really long-standing ideas about how this process is really quite simplistic. And that largely focuses on looking at cases when we generate patterns of muscle activity that are also simplistic, you know, cases like holding a glass of water and then, you know, seeing how things change as you, you know, add more water to the glass and it gets heavier and you have to increase how much force you're generating. So maybe if Ryan could pull the slide back up, I can. So, you know, we of course want to study more complex behaviors. So not just these very simple cases, but also cases where your muscles are contracting quite quickly, you know, just as when you're playing the piano. So to do that, I developed this new paradigm for studying this in monkeys. And so essentially, I trained them to play a game that's inspired by Pac-Man. And so the way that this works is that the monkey holds this holds this handle that's connected to this sensor here, and the sensor registers basically how hard he's pushing. How hard he pushes directly determines how high Pac-Man is on the screen. So as he, you know, pushes harder, Pac-Man moves higher up on the screen, and then as he just relaxes his muscle, Pac-Man falls back down to this baseline here. And so then study, you know, different types of behaviors, we cue him with this series of dots. And so it's the monkey's job to then modulate Pac-Man's position so as to eat these dots. So by changing the shape of this dot path, we can then effectively cue him to produce, you know, any kind of any pattern of muscle activity that we want to study. So just to give you a better sense for what this looks like, show you a little video of doing this task. So just to kind of orient everyone, on the top part of the screen here, you're looking at the view that the monkey was looking at during one of our experimental sessions. So you'll see Pac-Man over on the left here, and then the dots scrolling in from off screen. And so as I mentioned, you know, we're interested in studying these spinal motor neurons, and they drive muscle activity. And it actually turns out that, you know, as you may have heard, that neurons communicate via electrical impulses. And these spinal neurons, whenever they emit one of those electrical impulses, it also generates electrical signals in the muscles. So your muscles are really like amplifiers for your spinal cord. Mm. So if we want to understand how these spinal neurons work, we can just record muscle activity, and that essentially carries all the information about what these neurons are actually doing. So in this bottom picture, you'll see the electrical signals that we record from the muscles. This sort of narrower screen here will show a actually longer time duration of the signal. And then we have a little threshold here on this little red line. And so whenever the signal crosses that threshold, you'll see a little snippet of the signal over on this blown up side here. And basically what I want you to just notice is that you'll see a lot of these little snippets show up as Pac-Man moves higher up on the screen, and it'll really be locked to his behaviors. So
how many do they have to miss before like they fail at the task of those dots?
That's all part of the training process. So, you know, initially I'm quite generous, and you know, he can miss quite a bit and still be successful. But you know, once we get closer to, you know, being sort of experimental, recording ready, then I, you know, titrate it down. So, you know, if he misses just a handful of dots, then the trial fails. But you know, he learns this task really well and becomes really quite accurate.
Does the Pac-Man do the little dying dance too when they
So I actually did well, it's funny, I actually did initially program in all of the like fun Pac-Man sounds. So, you know, he would actually hear the like waka 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 when he's eating the dots, and you know, that, you know, whenever the trial failed, you would also hear the little, like, you know, dying sound.
Wow. So those clicking noises, those were representative of him moving the Pac-Man up and down the screen, right?
Yeah, I should have also noted there are two kinds of clicking noises. There were those that were associated with those electrical signals, the, you know, muscle and motor neuron spikes, and there's also separate clicks that were more irregular, but were just the juice delivery. So he essentially gets tang while he's playing this game.
Cool. Wow, you know, I'd be so fascinated just to see what this would look like when, because musicians, a big part of our activity is practicing. And you mentioned training, and that involves practicing too, because like with the Bud Powell piece, there's a section at the end, which I actually did not play perfectly, unfortunately, that I had to, this part. And that's the fun part in jazz, when you don't do what you were supposed to do, you just kind of, oh, I'm going to do that. But it's just like how a big part of practice in music is repetition. And what I would do is go slowly and see. A friend of mine said he didn't consider himself to have known to really have learned something if he couldn't play it five times in a row perfectly with no mistakes and no slips and no oops. And so I wonder, I'm just interested in terms of learning, like, does it become muscle memory after a certain point? Because I know if I was thinking every moment, oh, this chord comes next, I would not be able to play it in time. Same with, you know, could your monkeys, after a while, do they see the whole screen coming, or they only see a few dots, the next few, you know what I'm saying? Or do they see the whole pattern? And does that, how do you determine?
Yeah. So he only sees a, you know, restricted view of the whole upcoming pattern. But you know, and certainly over time learns to, you know, get really good at being able to adjust dynamically. You know, we've shown him new paths that, for example, that he's never seen before, and he's able to adjust and, you know, follow these new trajectories. So he certainly understands the, you know, association between what he's doing and what's happening on the screen.
Nice. And you were talking earlier today about other experiments that they've done with our furry friends.
our smaller furry friends. Yeah. So maybe if we can get the screen back up once more. So, you know, it's a really interesting question of really how do we learn to generate these complex sequences? And this is, you know, still a really active area of research and still much that we need to understand. But there was one really interesting study from several years ago that I wanted to mention. That was really cool. You know, so as I kind of said earlier, the you know, prevailing idea about motor cortex is that it's largely involved with executing movements. So it's that sort of final area within the brain that then sends output commands to the muscles. This study was really interesting in that it tried to dissociate between motor cortex's role in actually learning a complex sequence and also executing it. So what they did was train these rats on this sort of this complex lever tapping task. So the rat had to tap this lever once, and then they had to wait exactly 700 milliseconds and then tap the lever a second time. And so essentially, you know, it involves keeping track of time. And the funny thing too is that these rats all kind of developed their own stereotyped method for actually keeping track of time. So, you know, one rat might like touch the lever once and then do like a little like, you know, flurry of his paws and then come back down and tap the lever a second time. Another, you know, tapped it and then sort of paused and then like, you know, tapped the second lever.
keeping time. I love it.
Yeah, yeah. But what was really interesting is that they actually lesioned motor cortex and found that without their motor cortex, these rats could actually still execute these complex movements. But if they lesioned motor cortex in a rat that hadn't learned this task yet, it had difficulties, could never really learn as well as those that had their motor cortex intact. So it seemed to suggest that motor cortex is really involved with learning and maybe not as necessary for executing at least these sort of more coarse level movements.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
What's next? I think
there was yes. So I think, yeah, so I guess I just wanted to end by talking about, you know, we I think mentioned earlier this this human ability to perceive beats, right? And this ability for beat entrainment. So where you just sort of automatically kind of nod your head along to the beat, tapping your foot. And so, you know, they're again, you know, really sort of early days in sort of understanding the system. But and just to sort of clarify what I mean is that, you know, humans are really able to perceive beats even in the absence of an actual auditory sound. So, you know, whereas these red triangles here fall on, you know, the on and off beats where there's an actual note, even when there's not a note here in these white triangles, we're still able to actually, you know, predict and really anticipate where that beat falls. And so essentially, you know, there's this interesting manuscript recently that was published that, you know, suggested that this essentially is mediated by some complex interaction between multiple brain areas. So these premotor areas that essentially are involved with keeping track of where you are in a beat, and then these subcortical regions as part of the basal ganglia that are involved in actually initiating, you know, these sort of and really sequencing these proto movements into longer sequences.
Awesome, gosh. Najja, thank you so much. I'm sorry if I appeared a little bit starstruck by science today and asking kind of silly questions. I'm just in awe of just the human brain and of the work that y'all are doing and thinking a little bit about these movements that I know I take for granted and just the complexity and the wonder and the mystery behind it all. It's really, really inspiring. And so in the spirit of just moving and the fact that I think we all sit too much in front of our computers these days, I thought it'd be fun to end today with kind of a dance party and think about just as we move, just the wonderful thing that all these wonderful things that Najja has talked about, how it's all happening in our bodies and our brains and our brain neurons and motor neurons, our muscles. So we want to welcome some very important people to the screen who help make this all possible. First of all, of course, we thank Ryan Maloney and our fearless leader at the Zuckerman Institute, our director, Paula Croxon, and then our manager, Alyssa. I think she's also there. And although Lisa's not here with us today on screen, she also is just an incredible part of the team, and just thank them all. And so I'm going to start off by playing a piece by the great Mary Lou Williams. And I want y'all to think about this song as I want to encourage y'all to get up and dance. You know, we'll do it for you. We'll sacrifice ourselves. But just think about these things we talked about, just pattern, repetition, just or don't think about it, just move. So here we go. Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, should we go to some question and answer? Because I don't know if we have burning questions for Najja or for me. I think it'd be fun to.
Yeah, there was a couple of questions here. Let me see. Here was one.
How does fatigue impact neurological transmission? Yeah, interesting question. So fatigue certainly has an impact in terms of, you know, activating these spinal neurons and you know, facilitating muscle contractions, right? So as far as, it's not an area that I'm super familiar with, but I think that essentially it happens when you essentially have a depletion of the like fuel essentially that drives these muscle contractions, and that can then lead to rotation of different spinal motor neurons to, you know, sort of fill in when essentially one is unable to then drive the muscles sufficiently.
And I wonder if fatigue makes I know when I'm fatigued, I feel like my brain isn't working as smoothly. My executive is not as on point, maybe.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. Let's see.
Why are animals versus using human musicians learning a piece?
Or gamers.
Oh, why are animals versus using human musicians learning a piece or gamers? So, well, I guess if the question is to try to understand the, you know, processes that happen in the brain when we're producing, well, I mean, there's, you know, really a lot of sort of, you know, basic neurological functions that we still have to understand. And, you know, these, you know, largely rely on invasive recordings of large populations of neurons in the brain. And so that's, you know, why typically animal models are really convenient for that. You know, I'm not too familiar with many gamers who are willing to have their brains recorded from.
Well, I think also just the glories of living, just being alive and humans. These things that we do, we take it for granted because we just do them. But it's like, and from what I remember talking to a lot of the scientists, they're looking at very small specific things, like you said, one set into. Gamers are doing it's probably a very complex, like to unpack one thing that they're doing is
certainly there's, you know, this the last you know, manuscript that I was talking about is really suggesting a, you know, framework for understanding how multiple brain regions really coordinate. I mean, and that kind of thing is something that's still, and so probably would surprise many people, still relatively new. I mean, we're only just now being able to record from large populations of neurons within single brain regions. And so, you know, it's really a sort of new frontier to understand how multiple regions really interact and sort of coordinate, which would certainly underlie complex processes like, you know, gaming or playing music. Yeah. So, you know, it's really just sort of building blocks of first understanding the sort of basic components to how each region functions, and then we can start to put the pieces together.
Yeah. Very cool.
Good question. Uh-oh. Well, first of all, I didn't get to see, but I'm going to maybe watch the playback later. Thank y'all for dancing to that boogie woogie piece by Mary Lou Williams called Roland. And since pianists, we never got to sing in the choir. We never got to dance because we had to play. I kind of did a little mixed DJ of stuff that I thought, you know, because pianists, we sit too much and I'd like to dance too. We're going to send you out. And we hope you'll dance with us out there. Thank you so much for joining us. I'll let maybe Ryan close us with some comments before we hit the tape.
Sure. I just want to thank everybody for joining us. Please stick around for our dance party. But thank you to everyone at the Zuckerman. Thank you to Alyssa Mayer, to Lisa Din, to Najja for joining us this month. Najja Marshall, of course, and Paula Croxon, who helps push all this down the road. And it's been a big help to develop this partnership. It's really been one that is fruitful, and I think getting into some areas that I think hopefully both, you know, scientists and musicians and everybody in between can learn something, and it's accessible, and we really appreciate everybody for joining us. And of course, We wouldn't be able to do this without the great Helen Sung. So Helen, thank you so much for your commitment to this program and this partnership. And part of this that you guys don't see is also a partnership that we have in place with our friends over at Arts and Minds. And we do programs very similar to this, but with their audience as well. So this partnership has many arms and it reaches a lot of different people. So thank you all for making this happen. Are we gonna dance our way out? Is that the plan?
Yeah, I think
so. Right. Okay, so let's do it. I'll bring, I'll get this back up here. And all right, this is Helen's mix. So everybody's got to get up and dance, all right? Thank you, everybody. Thank you for tuning in. We will see you next month, and we have a date for our next session. Does anybody have it right in front of them?
Oops. No.
Oops. We do have a date for our next session, Music on the Brain. Check it out at...
It's on the last slide.
Is on the last slide. Oh, yeah. Let's bring it there. Najja, can you push us forward? There, yay! All right. So Prati Patel will be our guest neuroscientist, October 20th. This video will live on the National Jazz Museum in Harlem Facebook page and YouTube channel. So if anybody did not get a chance to see it, you can forward that on to anybody and hopefully... we can get some more folks to check things out. So on behalf of everyone at the museum, we thank you all, Helen, Najja, Paula, Alyssa, Lisa out in Cyberland, and everyone at Zuckerman. Thank you guys all for joining us. We will see you next month, October 20th. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ryan. Thanks, everyone.